In this packet, we will review some trigonometry. We will review angles, the six trig functions, identities and formulas, graphs, domain, range, and transformations. Angles can be measured in two ways, in degrees or in radians. The picture below shows the relationship between two measurements for the most frequently used angles. An angle is made up of an initial side and a terminal side. It is useful to note the quadrant where the terminal side falls. Positive angles start on the positive x axis and rotate counterclockwise. Negative angles start on the positive x axis and rotate clockwise. Here are a few examples. Here are a couple of examples of converting from radians to degrees and vice versa. A radian is defined by the radius of a circle. If you measure off the radius of the circle, then make the straight radius and curve it along the edge of the circle, the angle this arc marks off measures 1 radian, approximately 57.3 degrees. When using radians, you can determine the arc length using the formula below. An example. Now we will go over the 6 trigonometric ratios. Here is how we describe the different sides of the triangle surrounding the angle theta. SOHCAHTOA is a nice way to remember the different trig ratios. Here is an example. First, we need to use the Pythagorean theorem to find the missing side A. Now that we have all the sides, we can find the 6 trigonometric ratios. The following triangles will help you remember the trig functions of these special angles. Another way to remember some of the key trig ratios is using a table like this one below. My personal preference is to use the unit circle. No matter which your preferred method of remembering these key values, they all get you what you need. Domain and range of sine and cosine functions are just all real numbers, since the input values come from angles on the unit circle. Based on the way the domain values can start to cycle back over the same points to produce the same output over and over again, the range is said to be periodic. The largest value for sine and cosine is 1, and the lowest output value is negative 1. So the range for sine and cosine functions are negative 1 to 1. Since the functions of sine and cosine wrap around, we have this relationship here. The graphs of sine and cosine can be found by using key values like the 6 trigonometric ratios and values where sine and cosine are 1 and 0. When the sine or cosine functions has a coefficient in front, such as y equals a times sine x or y equals a times cosine x, this causes the graph to stretch or shrink its y values. This is referred to as the amplitude. If there is a coefficient in front of the x, this changes the length of the function's period. Below is a nice inequality to set up to find the new period. Let's do an example. Here we can see the amplitude is 2. So we can set up the highest and lowest output values on the graph. Since there is a number in front of the x, we can figure out what the period of the function is. Now that we have our new period, we can plot some key values. Another example. Here we can see the amplitude of the graph is 8. And again, we can find the new period. And now we look for some key points to plug in, mainly where the function fluctuates from negative 1 to 0 and to 1. And here is our wonderful graph of y equals negative 8 cos of 10x. Here's an example that shifts the graph to the left or right. We call that a phase shift. Same process as the previous examples. Label the amplitude, find the period, and plot some key points. When we plot the key points here, it's good to think about what values we would plug in if the pi over 4 wasn't there. Like 0, pi over 2, pi, 3 pi over 2, and 2 pi. This example we will save for class. This page has some trig identities that may be useful in calculus. Here's a quick review of solving a trigonometric equation. Here, once we get to a certain point, it is helpful to draw a diagram to finish the problem. From our diagram, we see that the possibilities for a negative sine value are in quadrant 3 and quadrant 4.